Nice boobs, fat boy.
Maybe you should skip a meal now and then.
Cutting back calories is misery. So we've all, most of us have tried it. If you cut back calories just by cutting back the intake of this or that food, you get hungry. And you're going to have this gnawing around the clock hunger. And it's miserable and it makes it impossible to stick to it.
Well, the true problem with counting calories is like a euphemism for just stay hungry. You know, count your calories until you reach a certain arbitrary number and then stay hungry.
Telling a kid to eat less is not going to work. I mean, kids are not going to eat less. I mean, you can try portion control, but they're going to be miserable and they're going to get it somewhere else.
The problem with this is these kids turn around and they want to eat 2 hours later because they're not satisfied.
Yeah, or get off your butt and move once in a while.
The current assumption is that because they sit and watch TV and sit in front of their games and are not active, and because they're eating more, that makes them fat. I think it's the other way around. I think they have a metabolic disturbance that makes them fat, and that makes them less energetic, more likely to be inactive, and to eat more.
Is exercise essential? Is it necessary? Absolutely. I am completely for exercise, but not for weight loss. Diet is about pounds, exercise is about inches. Diet is about weight, exercise is about health.
So in the 1990s, the USDA created the food pyramid, which told Americans to base their diets on grains. And we did. And instead of eating natural fats like butter and lard, we were told to switch to vegetable oils made from soybeans and corn. And we did.
That high carbohydrate, low fat diet that our government and most health professionals recommend is the very diet that is probably driving overeating.
This whole low fat experiment that we've all been a part of has ended up with us being obese and diabetic and hypertensive, and it's been pretty much an abject failure.
The USDA diet is a prescription for obesity for people who are sensitive to carbohydrate.
Well, low fat equals high carb. To make the foods look right and have consistency and look like the sort of the original full fat food, they have to add carbohydrates. So again, you're just putting more sugars into the diet, which is going to make the child gain more weight.
Not only did the low fat message not have science behind it, it's very destructive. Now we're seeing it on an astounding scale play out. The de facto proof that cutting fat is a very unhealthy way to live.
I think as physicians, there's a tendency to place the blame on patients. You know, these patients are not being compliant. They're not necessarily eating the way we're telling them to eat, but the fact is that they are. These people did follow the guidelines and started decreasing the fat in their diet and increasing the carbohydrates, and that's what's caused this balloon in the obesity, not just in kids but in adults as well.
Do you realize that there's only 1 teaspoon of dissolved sugar in our blood, and a 32-ounce soda has almost 50 teaspoons? So I see little kiddies coming out of the convenience market. Their parents have just bought them a big gulp. And I want to scream. I say, please, you're overloading that child's metabolism with sugar. If it doesn't, it's got to go somewhere, and it's going to go to fat.
But now we're told eating grains prevents all kinds of health problems. Is that true?
No, children don't need to eat grains. They don't need to eat bread. They don't need to eat these foods that we come to think of as natural or common foods or foods we've already always had, but that we've always had it, not for very long.
In fact, if you do very, very simple math in the sense of look at the actual essential nutrients in whole grains divided by the number of calories, you'll see that anything that they supposedly do well, fruits and vegetables do in a far more elegant fashion.
One of the characteristics of gluten sensitivity, one of its impacts on the brain, is it basically has the effect of creating what they call hypoperfusion of the brain. In other words, it cuts off the blood flow to the brain, and particularly the frontal cortex, which is the part of our brain that allows us to focus, that allows us to manage our emotions well, our emotional states, gives us the capacity to plan and organize and have good judgment about things.
And the good news is, you don't need a perfect diet to be strong and healthy. You just need a good diet.
The first thing you can do, and the most important thing you can do for your kids, is get sugar out of their diet. Minimize their exposure to sugar. I think the evidence, Bill Davis, for instance, talking about wheat, I think you should get wheat out of their diet as much as you can, and certainly cut back on refined carbohydrates in general. Those are the first two steps, and I would add, get the omega-6 oils out of their diet. So if you did those three things, I think you're giving your child a big, big advantage in terms of nutritional health.
When kids get on a nutrient-dense diet, such as a diet of meats, meat, fish, eggs, poultry, their fats, vegetables, good things, they get better. They get better in every way. They can concentrate, they get better grades, they feel better, they aren't as anxious. Their self-esteem improves. And this is what parents want. This is what teachers want. This is what we all want for these next up-and-coming generations. And I don't think you can do better than that.